Good morning and welcome to Macquarie Chapel Presbyterian Church. It's great to have you here this morning. If my eyes don't deceive me, you're all a little further down the front than usual. Some of you. If you're still at the back where you usually are, Val, that's okay. Maybe it's a little bit more cozy and warm. We were talking this morning about the fact that it's 3 degrees warmer this morning than it has been the last couple of mornings. So I hope you appreciated those 3 degrees this morning. Just a few announcements, things that are happening in and around our church. First of all, I got an email from Robin McKenzie Hunter just wanting me to thank you, the 830 congregation, for cards, flowers, emails, phone calls, and also for those who attended the service on Thursday. He greatly appreciated the thoughts and concerns during this time. Another thing as well is that we did mention there was a survey with regards to the mission statement. I've had about 13 responses to that across the three services, which has been very helpful, but always looking for more. If you're not able to hit the link that is in REMAC and you want to just talk to me, more than happy to have a chat about thoughts regards to our mission statement. Other announcements as well that will be on the screen. We're currently renting out the church manse to Brendan and Sue Pang, who come to our 10:30 service. They were doing a knockdown and rebuild, and they have almost rebuilt. And so at the end of July, or thereabouts, they will be moving, and the manse will be available for rent. We're just letting people know within the congregation that is the case, because it is easier for us to rent it with connections, bypassing real estate agents is where I'm coming from. We love real estate agents, Turda, but if we don't have to pay commission, that's great. The other thing is, because the Woolcott family's moved out of the Ryde manse, Ryde Presbyterian Church asked if we could also let people know about their manse as well. So we have a couple of properties available, if you'd like. You've got a choice. But anyway, if you know somebody who might be looking for a home in the Meadowbank, Ryde, Marsfield, Eastwood sort of area, those two places are available. Once again, just an update, Macquarie University Ministry to Students is something that we're hoping to kick off shortly, and at the moment as well, we're looking at doing that together with Ryde Presbyterian Church, which is exciting. YMAC continues, as does JMAC on a Friday. Please pray for those ministries. And the last Friday of the month, we have our cafe on the corner. And so I believe that's this Friday. So we will be having dinner, and that will be sort of with YMAC and JMAC as well. So please pray for that. We're endeavouring to build community around that Friday night. The other thing I'd like to announce is that Chi Un has signed a contract this week to be our new youth pastor for 2 days a week. So he'll be looking after YMAC and JMAC on a Friday night, as well as Sunday morning and Sunday evening, some of the youth activities that we have during those two services. So please pray for Chi. He starts on the 30th of May, which is next Sunday. He's very excited, and we look forward to having him join our staff team. ESL continues on a Monday morning. Please continue to pray for that ministry and also our ministry on Tuesday playtime. That would be great if you could remember them in your prayers. And finally, MacChaps, that's this Saturday. Please RSVP by Tuesday the 25th. It's going to be at Rowan Ben's place. If you've had a barbecue that's been cooked by Rowan Ben, then you would know that it is something not to be missed. So please attend that, gentlemen, if you would like. That's it in the way of announcements at this time. Please also, we'll continue to be praying for Robin and his family. Continue to pray for those who are sick within our church as well. I wanted to begin as a call to worship by reading Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 to 30. One of my favourite little passages where Jesus gives us an invitation. He says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the invitation that we have to come to you. We thank you that it is an invitation to a place of rest. We thank you that it is an invitation that is freely offered. And we thank you for the opportunity we have this morning to meet together. We pray that we would be encouraged in our relationship with you, that in some ways you might work in us this morning to change us, to transform us, to shape us and to mold us, to look and be more like you. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing our first hymn, and I must say I was listening to the choir practicing beforehand, and I thought it's an interesting tactic by the government to give you 2 weeks off, because you sounded so much more, you know, it was great hearing you this morning. And so we rejoice that we can sing this morning, unmasked as well. So we're going to sing hymn 52, "Not Unto Us, O Lord of Heaven."
Good morning. Once or twice before, I've read you a prayer from My Little Prayers. It was a book of prayers that my maternal grandmother gave me as a birthday present when I was very, very young indeed. And it's basically worn out. Of a time when the language of the day is not quite the language of this day, but nevertheless, they're the sort of prayers that I was brought up with. And I'll just read you one before I do the prayers of adoration and confession. Pray when the morn is breaking. Pray when the moon is bright. Pray with the eaves declining. Pray in the hush of night. with mind made clear of tumult, all meaner thoughts away. Make thou my soul transparent, seek thou with God to pray. Remember all who love thee, all who are loved by thee, and next for those who hate thee, pray thou, for such there be. Last for thyself in meekness, a blessing humbly claim, and link with each petition thy great Redeemer's name. But if it's e'er denied thee in solitude to pray, should holy thoughts come o'er thee upon life's crowded way, e'en then the silent breathing that lifts thy soul above shall reach the throned presence of mercy, truth, and love. And the prayer of adoration and confession is not mine, but from the works of Howard Thurman, and he wrote quite extensively on matters of religion. And so join me if together we pray a prayer of adoration and confession. God is with me in the sense that God is the creator and the sustainer of life. This is a part of my general thought and experience. There is something so big and vast about God as creator and sustainer of all life. And it is hard for me to feel that I am included, but God is with me. All around me are certain expressions of orderliness, of beauty, of wonder and delight. The regularity of sunrise and sunset and the fragile loveliness of a wisp of cloud fringed with silver. The wonder of day dawning and the delight and companionship, all of these are God's handiwork. God is with me. Again and again, I'm stirred by some experience of tenderness, some simple act of gratuitous kindness, moving from one person to another, some quiet deed of courage, wisdom, or sacrifice, or some striking movement of unstudied joy that bursts forth in the contagion of merry laughter. I know God is with me. Always there is a persistent need for some deep inner assurance, some whisper in my heart, some stirring of spirit within me that renews, recreates, and steadies. Then, whatever betides the light or shadow, I can look out on life with quiet eyes. God is with me. Hear now our silent gratitude for our blessings and also the confessions of our hearts. Lift our prayers into one, Lord, and help us remember that you're with us always. Now please join me as we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. As Dave mentioned, it's lovely to have a choir after a short break. And this morning we have an arrangement of Psalm 117, Praise the Lord, all nations, praise him, all people, by Charles Gounod, a French composer. And a few words about the composer. Charles Gounod, best known for his Ave Maria based on a work by Bach, as well as his opera Faust. Gounod gave serious consideration to joining the priesthood, but he changed his mind before actually taking holy orders and went back to composition. For 4 years, Gounod lived in England in Blackheath. There he became the first conductor of what is now the Royal Choral Society. Later in his life, Gounod returned to his early religious impulses, writing a lot of sacred music. One of his anthems became the official national anthem of Vatican City. Gounod died in 1893. His funeral took place in Paris, with Camille Saint-Saëns playing the organ and Gabriel Fauré conducting the choir.
This morning's Bible reading is at Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 1 to 12, at the potter's house. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Go down to the potter's house, and there I will give you my message. So I went down to the potter's house, and I saw him working at the wheel. But the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. So the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. He said, "Can I not do with you, Israel, as this potter does, declares the Lord? Like the clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hand, Israel. If at any time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down and destroyed, and if that nation I warn repents of its evil, then I will relent and not inflict on it the disaster I have planned. And if another time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be built up and planted, and if it does evil in my sight and does not obey me, then I will reconsider the good I had intended to do for it. Now therefore, say to the people of Judah and those living in Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says. Look, I am preparing a disaster for you and devising a plan and plan against you. So turn from your evil ways, each one of you, and reform your ways and your actions. But they will reply, it is no use. We will continue with our own plans. We will all follow the stubbornness of our evil hearts. This is the word today.
We're going to have our next hymn, which is one of the hymns that I have an earliest memory of singing in church, and that is number 63, To God Be the Glory.
Present our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. May we pray. Come, let us to the Lord our God with contrite hearts return. The Lord is gracious, nor will leave the desolate to mourn. Almighty God, maker of all things, and Father of us all, you have shown us in Christ the purpose of your creation and called us to be responsible citizens in the world. We thank you for your blessing of us day by day, for the gift of human life, and for our loving families. We pray for our loved ones, far and wide, and ask you to keep them safe from harm. We thank you that we live in a peaceful environment. At the same time, we ask you to show us how best we can help those who suffer in places where there is war, famine, and difficult circumstances of all kinds. We pray now for our leaders, for all who are in authority, and thereby need your wisdom as they carry out their duties from day to day. Dearest Father, be with those recovering from operations. Be with the sick. Be with the dying. We pray for the many people throughout the world who are suffering from coronavirus and who at the same time lack the vital resources needed for its treatment. Jesus has said, "Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." So may it be. We think of those in our church family and pray that their needs will be met. Especially today, we pray for Robin Mackenzie Hunter and son. Father of all, we bring these prayers before you in the precious name of Jesus, our Lord and Saviour, Comforter and undying friend. Amen.
Let's stand and sing hymn 64, Praise to the Holiest in the Height.
Thank you.
It's great to sing a hymn with the word smote. It's also great that it was in relation to God's love, not his wrath with which he smote. We're looking at one of the probably the most well-known passage in Jeremiah today. The idea of the potter's house. If you've got an NIV Bible, you'll see that the heading for chapter 18 is At the Potter's House. I was feeling particularly uncreative when I thought of a title for the sermon. It's called The Potter's House. But Jeremiah 18, 1 to 12, and we read this idea of Jeremiah being sent by God down to see, to observe what the potter is doing. And I thought it might be helpful for us to have some images this morning with what it is that Jeremiah may have or may not have seen. I don't know what you think of when you think of pottery and what potters do, whether you think that they are people who do the same thing over and over again and there's a general lack of creativity, whether this picture that is on the screen, I hope it's on the screen, I say that in faith, could actually be a scene in any sort of, shop where they produce things en masse, or whether it's something that maybe the potter had a little bit more creativity with, and everything was a little bit different, a little bit unique, and that there was a bit of heart and soul and creativity that had gone into what the potter was making. I don't know what your thinking is as you think about this. I have somebody in my life who has endeavoured to do pottery and has had lessons on the wheel. And so they discovered firsthand how easily it is to mar the work that the potter is doing and have to start again. When you look at images on the internet of different sorts of pottery, you realize that there is a world of creativity that is there as to what it is that a potter can make. Indeed, I guess the possibilities are as endless as there are people. And the way each and every one of us is different and individual, in the same way a potter has that opportunity. And so it's an interesting metaphor that God has asked Jeremiah to think about, isn't it? He says to Jeremiah, look at this. Look at the potter, the way he creates something. And I think for many of us, I know for me, I sort of tend to think this. which if you Google clay pot, is one of the first images to come up. This is a clay pot. And yet it's so different to what it is that could have been being made. It's interesting, isn't it? But what is this metaphor that Jeremiah has been asked to think about? Go down to the potter's house and there I will give you my message. He says to Jeremiah, go and have a look at what the potter's doing and I'll speak to you there what I want to say. And so we're told, he says, so I went down to the potter's house and I saw him working at the wheel. So once again, this is at a wheel. But the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. So the potter simply formed it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him. And then it says, the word of the Lord came to me. So this is the message that God wants Jeremiah to hear. He said, can I not do with you, Israel, as this potter does? Like the clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hand, Israel. Do you remember what the name of this series is? It's a kingdom that is broken to be rebuilt. And this is the very image we have here. Something is being made and it doesn't work, and so instead it is reshaped, it is reformed into what it is that God wants. And this is my first point for this morning, is simply that God is, that's not my first point, is that God is God. God makes it clear in his message to Jeremiah that he will do the forming here. He's the one who's decided what it is that he wants in his people. They are to, after all, reflect who he is. And one of the things about Jeremiah so far, from 1 to 17, is that it's really clear that God's people don't reflect God. And so he will form his people. In other words, he will influence them. Think of what a potter does. He will apply pressure. He will vary the conditions. If the clay is too dry, he will add some water. And so he's going to vary the conditions, and he's going to ultimately form a people to his likeness, to bear the sort of fruit that he calls them, indeed he originally created them to bear. I love the way scripture, I love the way God is so creative, and he gives us metaphor and images from everyday life. It doesn't have to be creation. In this situation, it's the creativeness of a man, isn't it? It's the potter that God points to and says, look, this is what I am doing. It's like this man. But Jesus also gave us metaphor as to what it is that God would do. And God's desire to shape his people doesn't finish with Jeremiah. In fact, that's why he sends Jesus, because he continues to want to shape his people. And so Jesus gives us this image, not of a potter, but a gardener. He says, I'm the true vine and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit. With every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, he shapes. And so that it will be even more fruitful, so that it will look like what he wants it to look like. And this is a part of the privilege of being God and being the one who created his people in his image. It's interesting, once again, with vines and pruning and stuff, we could sort of have a bit of a, what is a standard picture if you go to the Hunter Valley or South Australia and you see rows and rows, monotonous rows, row after row after row of identical vines, each one pruned exactly the same way so as to generate the most fruit. And we can sometimes lose sight of what it is that God is actually doing in his creativity. He wants to create something beautiful in us, something unique, something special. And what it is that he wants to create in your life is not exactly the same as what he wants to create in my life or in the life of the person next to you. But as a people, he wants to bring each and every one of us with our uniqueness together to form something beautiful, something different. And so the second point, though, so the first point is God is God. The second point is that what he is after here is the very best. That's who he is, and that's who he calls us to be. And so in the passage, in verse 4, it says, but the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. I don't know if anyone's had experience on a potting wheel. You would, if you have, you would know how easy it is to mar it. You'd also know how hard it is just to get that lump of clay on centre, and to not be trying to shape something that's doing this. It's hard, it takes skill. And here God likens himself to somebody who's a skilled artisan. It's marred in his hands, so the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it, and this is key, as seemed best to him. He wants what is best here. He is not happy with something that is not the best. And so God is God. He will shape us and form us, and he will create us into something that is perfect. And that is his desire. That's his role, that his task that he has taken on. The very best. It's important not to forget the first point and remember that he is God. So there's some scary stuff in this passage there, isn't there? It's essentially saying, if you guys can't bring yourself up to standards, I'm going to bring you up to standard, and it's going to hurt a little bit. And I'm God. If at any time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down and destroyed, that happens. And yet if at another time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be built up and planted, that happens. He is God. It's really important for us this morning not to forget the fact that he is God and he is good. And so Romans 8:28 reminds us that the pain that he is about to put Israel through is not because he is a God who just loves to punish, that he's punitive, that he has a desire to smote us or smite us. In Romans 8:28 it says, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." That actually links in really well this morning, doesn't it? Because the reality is that he is shaping us and forming us as his people, not just for his own good, but for ours. This is who we were created to be. To be people who are loved by God, connected to God. And as we've thought about previously, people whose hearts know that they were created to love God. And so that brings us to the third and final point for this morning. That as God's people, we've been formed by love for resting, connecting, and being in God, the people God's called us and created us to be. We get a picture of what God wants to form his people into as we read through Jeremiah. And we get that picture from what it is that he asks them to do and not to do. So if you were to flick back over the last 17 chapters of Jeremiah, you'd get a picture of what God wants to form his people into. He wants them to be faithful. And one of the ways we know that is because the last 17 verses, God has been saying, "You're not faithful. You need to be faithful." They haven't been faithful to him. And he's used the image of them being like a prostitute or an adulterous wife. The fact that they haven't had a care or concern for him, even though they're his people. That they've gone after other gods, that they have not been faithful. God wants to form them into faithful people. The other thing is that they haven't been true or truthful. They haven't been true to who they've been created to be, but they haven't been truthful either. If you read through the first 17 chapters, you will see that they are a deceitful people. They are a people who lie, and they're not living in the truth. They're not being who they are supposed to be. One of the things that a lot of us, I think I didn't come to understand this until very recently, is that each and every one of us has a soul. And if we live a life that is not true, it sort of slowly erodes our soul. Our soul actually loves it when we, in our actions, in our body, in our heart, in our mind, are all living in truth. When we do that, our soul sings, it flourishes, it thrives. But when it doesn't, we might be physically fit, but we are speaking lies. Or we are following things other than what our heart was designed and created to follow. Then we're not in truth. And our soul disintegrates. And so God's calling these people to be truthful because that's the best thing for them. That's how they will thrive and sing and how their souls will be healthy. But the other thing is that these aren't a humble people. There are people who have decided to put themselves in the place of God. They're not content. We're told, in fact, in the first 17 chapters that they are always striving for and grabbing at what it is that they want. They're not humble. They're not content. And yet, as we look through Gospels, especially as we look at the life of Jesus, even Jesus, the Son of God, has a humility about himself where he serves those that he is teaching, where he washes their feet, where he dies on a cross for them. And so this third and final point is that God is going to form us to be faithful and to be true and truthful and to be humble and content. But if you've got your NIV Bible open, you may or may not have noticed where the second half of chapter 17 goes. It's actually headed "Keeping the Sabbath Day Holy," which is really strange. If you go to the beginning of chapter 17, it continues on with more of what we've had in the previous 16 chapters. Judah's sin is engraved with an iron tool, inscribed with a flint point on the tablets of their hearts and on the horns of their altars. That's the first verse of chapter 17. It's just the same thing again. guys, you're not being who God has called you to be. And then out of the blue, Jeremiah moves to talking about the Sabbath. And why is it that he talks about the Sabbath before this bit about the potter's house? I think it's worth thinking about for a second. So I'm looking at chapter 17, verses 19 through to the end of chapter 17 for a minute. There's this idea of being faithful to the Sabbath and the place that it will play in God's people being shaped. And you might ask the question, what does keeping the Sabbath have to do with being shaped and formed to be God's people? What does it have to do with being faithful and true and truthful and humble and content? Well, they're to be a people who will rest in God and rely in Him. And that's what Sabbath helps us to do. It helps us to rest in God and rely in Him. To set aside the things that we feel need to be done and rest in Him. One of the things that that does is highlights the fact that we're not God. It also recognizes that we have limits that God does not, and yet we do. There are three really big things that help us to get closer to being faithful, to living in truth, and to being humble and content. Can you see that? That the Sabbath is actually really helpful in forming God's people to be who they will be. It's interesting that in the Ten Commandments, it seems to be the one commandment which is genuinely a gift from God to us. And that's powerful. A Jewish rabbi by the name of Abraham Joshua Heschel, what a great name for a rabbi, said this about the Sabbath, and I just want for a second just to paint a picture of the Sabbath to maybe help you see why Jeremiah has put it here before he talks about God's people being formed. Rabbi Abraham says, unless one learns how to relish the taste of Sabbath while still in this world, unless one is initiated in the appreciation of eternal life, one will be unable to enjoy the taste of eternity in the world to come. I don't necessarily agree with that, but I think he highlights a really, really big point, and that is that eternal life starts now. And Sabbath is a great way of stepping into that eternal life now. He goes on to say, the essence of the world to come is Sabbath eternal, and the seventh day in time is an example of eternity. In other words, Rabbi Abraham is saying, this is really, really key and important to understanding what it's like to be in God's presence now. And the reality is that if you look at Scripture, nobody stands in God's presence and is not changed as a result. The Sabbath is going to be an opportunity for God's people, if they seek to do it, to be able to be changed and to be able to be formed. In chapter 17, verse 19 to the end, where Jeremiah is talking about the Sabbath, he makes it really clear, if you do this, things will be different. If you observe the Sabbath, things will be different. If you don't observe the Sabbath, nothing will change. Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 12 goes on to talk about the Sabbath. It says, moreover, I also gave them my Sabbaths. Remember, this is, like I said, the one command which seems to be this gift. I also gave them my Sabbath to be a sign between them and me, that they might know that I am the Lord who sanctifies them. The Sabbath actually plays a part in us understanding that God changes us and shapes us and forms us. God himself says, if you practice the Sabbath, you'll understand that I am sanctifying you. Sanctifying means to make holy. It means to change, to transform. We often think of Sabbath as an onerous thing, and I think if we are in a season of our life of retirement, we can often think that the Sabbath command has become true. I now rest 6 days and work the seventh. Now, I know that a lot of people tell me when they retire, they say, I'm busier than I've ever been. Getting some nods. Yeah. You see, you don't have to be doing paid work to be able to have something to step out of and rest. In fact, I want to read to you what Wayne Mueller, who wrote a fair bit about the Sabbath, said about the Sabbath. He said, "Sabbath is not dependent upon our readiness to stop. We do not stop when we are finished. We do not stop when we complete our phone calls, finish our project, get through this stack of messages, or get to this report that is due tomorrow. We stop because it's time to stop. It's the Sabbath." He says, "We stop because there are forces larger than we that take care of the universe. And while our efforts are important and necessary and useful, they are not, nor are we, indispensable. The galaxy will somehow manage without us for this hour, this day, and so we are invited, nay commanded, to relax and enjoy our relative unimportance, our humble place at the table of a very large world." Can you see the way it shapes us with regards to humility? Let's face it, when we're busy, sometimes we're tempted to feel, "I am busy, therefore I am important. I am busy, therefore I am indispensable." And one of the key things with the Sabbath is it says, "I will stop because I'm not indispensable. I will stop because I'm actually relatively unimportant. And I will stop because the God who shapes me and forms me has said, stop." You don't have to be working a 5-day week to be able to stop, do you? We can all take the opportunity to stop. He goes on to finish by saying, "Do not be anxious about tomorrow. Jesus said again and again, let the work of this day be sufficient. Sabbath says, be still, stop. There is no rush to get to the end because we are never finished." So God invites, nay, commands us to stop. That's what he says to his people here. Before he says, "I'm going to shape you and form you." I guess it doesn't have to be by observing a Sabbath, a 24-hour period, one in every 7 days. It doesn't have to be that way. But it's a great rhythm to have in life. To have one day in every 7 where you stop and you sit with God. And you allow him to shape you, to change you. You actually commit that percentage of your life, of every single week, to being formed by God. I'd like to encourage you, myself, each and every one of us, to consider this. How it is in my week this week, I will allow time for God to shape me and form me. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have not finished with us. We thank you that you continue to want to make us more and more like your Son, Jesus. Lord, we are often tempted to think that somehow this will just happen. And yet you call us into activities that you have earmarked as activities that you will use to help this to happen. Lord, help us to find time this week to stop so that we can be with you, that we can sit in your presence and be changed, that we can be reminded of your graciousness and your love, that you have invited us into your rest, that we might fellowship with you, that we might be changed and formed. And Lord, we ask that you would shape us and form us to the image that you have in mind, not the image that we have in mind. Help us to let go of our image of who we should be. Instead, help us to conform to the image that you have in mind. And Heavenly Father, we just celebrate now that you are God and that we are not. And we celebrate the fact that you have invited us into something that is much bigger than any one of us. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, a great hymn to finish up with that in mind is hymn number 61, "The Lord is King." Thank you. Just a reminder that there is the opportunity for free will giving at the back. I will pray for that now. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness, your love, and your mercy to us. We pray, Lord, that you would use our gifts that are given to you. Use them for the extension of your kingdom. Use them for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you. The Lord mercifully, with his favour, look upon you and fill you with all spiritual benediction and grace, that in this life and in the world to come you may be partakers of eternal life. Amen.